Hello everyone and welcome to yet another video podcast here on the War Bonds channel. If you don't know me, my name is Eric. I'm a locomotive engineer by profession, an avid model railroader, and just a lifelong rail enthusiast. I just recently did the video on the Nutrien 47-foot potash hopper that seemed to be a really big hit based on the comments and the views and the likes and everything. And I actually had one gentleman who left a kind comment in the comment section that I was wondering when you were going to get around to talking about your cars. So since that seems to be something of interest, we're just going to make a little series on talking about some of my builds that I've done and maybe even talk about some of them that are still in progress. But anyway, in video podcast, either number 8 or 9, I believe it was number 9, I talked about making a cab interior for the GP60M. Now, which that may be one last thing that I can do for the GP60M series is talk about that, but we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. However, I mentioned a caboose that I had built. It was a Rock Island caboose that I had built, and I was talking about the interior of that. So since I touched on that, I figured, why not let's talk about the actual build itself and show you a little bit of in progress pictures and give you the backstory on how I came to build this car. Now, one of the things I've said before is I'm mostly a modern guy. However, I still find the older stuff interesting and it's fun to build, but I'm not really a Rock Island fan. So how does a Santa Fe guy build a Rock Island caboose? So the story was, back in 2021, a friend of mine, the late Todd Thunderbush Pearson, and I were out in Missouri rail fanning the old Santa Fe, and we had another gentleman along with us, and I had never met this gentleman before, but we got to talking and got to know each other, and I mentioned how I was into 1-inch scale, and I showed him some of the pictures of cars that I've built. And he got really excited. Wow, you do fabulous work. He said, hey, do you think there's a possibility that you could build me a 1-inch scale Rock Island caboose? Yeah, sure. I'm sure I could. I've not built any cabooses before, but I can certainly give it a shot. I think I can do what you want. And so we got to making plans for it. Well, quoted him a price, and which... that little bit of information is going to come in the story here in a few minutes, but started doing the research, because that's one of the things I love doing is when I get interested in something, man, I can spend hours and hours researching it because I want to get it right. I want to know everything that I can about that project before I even begin to start it. So we talked back and forth, and he didn't really have a good picture of what he wanted, but eventually, as I kept looking, I'd say, hey, is this it? Well, it's kind of similar to that. Is this it? Yeah, that's it right there. Okay, now we're on the same page. So this particular caboose, or the series, was built in 1930s, but they were actually boxcar conversions. So the Rock Island was short on cabooses, and they couldn't really afford to buy new ones, so it's like, well, hey, let's take some of these like World War I era boxcars and convert them into cabooses. And that's what they did. So they don't really look like your normal looking caboose, I guess, for lack of a better term, but they're still interesting nonetheless. But I thought, well, hey, the cool thing about this is that I'm trying to build a model of a wood prototype. So hey, this is like license to steal. The sky's the limit on this project. So anyway, I started building this caboose and was showing the gentleman that wanted it done in progress pictures as I was going along. And then eventually I kind of got to a plateau where, which usually kind of happens in the summertime, I think for a lot of us, that just not feeling it right now. So I put it aside, which he wasn't in a big hurry for it. So it worked out just as well. So when I finally started getting back into it and I was making some good progress, well, then all of a sudden, after a while, well, gentleman cut off communication with me. Like, okay, after so long, I'm not going to beg you. And I started this car, or this Caboose, but no money had exchanged hands. So it actually ended up working out into my favor, even though I was a little disappointed at first, but it worked out into my favor because, unfortunately, I underquoted myself when I gave him a price for this Caboose and realized that just buying the materials for the body, buying the trucks, the couplers, the detail parts and everything was practically just breaking even and giving free labor. So it actually ended up working out to my advantage. Because of the fact that I was only gonna break even on this thing initially, I neglected to put certain parts in it. So Todd had asked me, hey, are you gonna put a cab interior in this? I'm like, well, I don't really know. Well, after the customer ghosted me, I thought, you know what? I am gonna put a cab interior in it. I'm gonna put rivet details on this thing. So because since it's mine, you know what? I'm gonna finish it up the way it needs to be. And if I get to sell it and somebody likes it and they either want it or I build another one specifically for that customer, hey, wonderful. Now, I will admit that after building this thing, it was really cool and it actually made me want to build some more old stuff. So I'm sure there's going to be some stuff down the line that isn't necessarily in my era, but it's going to be exciting enough for me to actually want to build. So it ended up being a good thing, a good experience in building this Caboose. So that's what we're going to talk about. Okay, so now that we've figured out everything and I'm on the same page with the customer, okay, now it's time to begin the real research. The big problem is that these Cabooses were made back in the 1930s. By the time I was doing this project, it was 2021. So it's not very likely that I can just go out and find one of these Cabooses and get the information I needed. So I had to figure out a way to find a boxcar red outside brace Caboose. So after hours of researching and trying to put in different words into Google, all of a sudden, believe it or not, I found one. The Oklahoma Railway Museum down in Oklahoma City actually had one intact. And I believe when it was retired, it was bought by a private owner who had it for a number of years, used it as his own personal office. And I believe the gentleman passed away, and upon his passing, it was donated to the Oklahoma Railway Museum. So they actually, it was in rough shape, and they actually went and redid it to make it look like it would have been in its original form. So I'm thinking, this is great. Well, Oklahoma City is probably about a 6-7 hour drive for me. So why not make a trip down there if I have to? So I was all ready to grab my tape measure and everything. We were going to Oklahoma City until I looked at their website a little bit more and I found drawings. So these would have been the drawings that Rock Island had drawn up and would have used to make their fleet of outside brace Cabooses. So this was going to be wonderful. So what I ended up doing is taking my iPad, downloaded the drawings to my iPad, and I readjusted the size of them to HO scale. Now I have a little bitty ruler that I can actually put on there that measures feet in HO scale, O scale, and even N scale. And that's what I ended up using. So this was great. I got to save gas, time, and everything to not go down there, but actually have everything in the comfort of my own home to get started on this. So when I began, I ended up using aspen wood for the start of this project. But I later found out that, yeah, I don't really like aspen that well because it's, as I've said in previous videos, I like to use poplar because poplar is really hard. Aspen's a little softer. However, aspen actually worked out pretty good because, as I said earlier, this is a wood caboose. Well, you know darn well that the real ones are going to get beat up. They're going to have marks on them and stuff like that. Not that I wanted to make this look, you know, hideous and like it had been beat up. But, you know, if there were a few little mistakes here and there, considering that I'm not modeling a brand new car, if it had a little ding here or there, okay, it didn't, wasn't going to matter too much. But it ended up coming out really well. So we'll start in with some of the in-progress photos as to how I ended up doing everything. In this first view, we see the fabrication of the ends as well as the floor of the caboose. The ends were all cut the same so that when I put them together, symmetry was perfect for the peak of the roof. We see here the sides have been fabricated as well as the cupola, and all the lines are drawn to show the separation of the boards that make up each side, as well as the drawings of where the windows would go. For the windows, I took each side, ran through the table saw twice, and then took blocks to represent the separation between the windows. Initially, I was going to use a jigsaw to do this, but I found that that was next to impossible if I wanted to keep my sanity. In this view here, we've got the roof and the cupola is together. Also, we can see that the lines have been scribed to show the board separation as well as the outside bracing. In this case here, we were just working with a little lettering to size everything up to see what works. And in this view here, we see once again the outside bracing, and this time we see some rivet detail that I started to add. Needless to say, that was quite a bit of work, but it was definitely worth it for the final outcome of the product. And we see here the interior that I started building just from scrap wood. The underframe piping and appliances have been applied as well as the center sill. Now in this case, we've got the underframe, floor, and everything painted. The inside here, I used some drab green, which seems to be the standard color that was used in a lot of cabooses and locomotives for many, many years. Now the body has been painted as well. And the stack for the potbelly stove has been installed as well. Now we can see how the interior all falls together with the bunks, the cupola, the seats, the toilet, and I actually stained the floor to really give it just a nice little flair, make it pop a little bit. And now, for the first time, the painted car body and frame are together. And in this case here, we've actually got the lettering put on there with the right font. You can see more of the rivet detail. Now in this case, we've got the weathering. Just a little bit of light weathering is all we wanted. Didn't want to make it totally filthy. Now we see the real car that this was modeled after. Now before the haters begin, yes, the colors are different between my caboose and the one in the picture. But look at these pictures here, and we can see how much different the color is on these individual examples. Now, one of the things I tell people when they think that they take two drops of this and four drops of that to make the perfect Rock Island boxcar red or whatever they're trying to achieve, it doesn't always work that way, because you never know what shop has painted which car, and there might be a variation in the mixtures they use. Needless to say, these were old cars. You're painting wood, and the sunlight and the cool weather, the cold weather and snow tend to do a lot of things to alter the paint. So the sun fades it, and the cold weather, you just never know what happens. So either way, maybe everything doesn't look exactly the same, but there were over 100 examples of these, and I'm sure they all look different. And probably the car that I'm modeling probably did look like this when it was brand new or at least freshly painted. And here she is in action, ready for the rails. Well, that's about it. And I hope that you've really enjoyed this video documentary of the Rock Island Caboose build. Going back through it, it's like, wow, now I remember some of this stuff. And then like, oh yeah, now I really remember some of this stuff where it was a pain in the butt. And unfortunately, I always say that my projects have a little mark of bad in them because there's always some naughty words that are being said when something gets frustrating. But in the end, everything's rewarding. Now, one of the other things that I did want to point out about this in regards to what we discussed earlier about the lighting and the color of the caboose, even if you look back at some of the pictures of my caboose that I shot on the same day in different locations, you could even see the colors different. The day that I actually painted the caboose, it looked one way as opposed to the way it looked later on. So lighting has a lot to do, but also in the old photographs that I showed you, you got to think that film was different back then and things change over time. So anyway, that's just another one of the notes for the haters that are going to challenge me on it, which if somebody does, you know what? They're entitled to their own opinion, but this is what I did. This is my build and this is the way it turned out. And the only person I have to please is myself. So I'm satisfied with what I've done. And I know that for the majority of you, you're happy with what I'm able to share and the content that I'm able to present. Now, one more thing I wanted to say before we go is the GP60M project. Now, it's going to the back burner just for a little bit. So don't worry, because I know a lot of you have been reaching out to me with the comment section about, hey, you know, what are you going to do here? Or how's the project coming along? It is still coming along, but it's going to the back burner for a little bit, only because of the fact that I am out of parts and there's really not much more I can do right at this moment to keep the content interesting for you. Now, within the next month or two, I'm going to be making a trip down to Texas to visit a friend of mine down there who has actually had some parts made and is ready and willing for us to start rolling hard on this thing so that hopefully by the time I come back from that trip, it's operational. But don't worry, when I go down there, you guys will be coming along with me and we'll see the progress made on that GP60M. One little last thing that I was noticing as I was going back through the editing process, I mentioned that I was going to put a cab interior in this caboose. Now, yeah, it was a little mistake, but actually not really, because cabooses have always had various names, and just the few that I can think of are Caboose, Way Car, Crummy, Hack, Cab. So, depending on what railroad a person works for, what part of the country you're in, there's even more names that I'm sure that are out there other than just the few that I mentioned. So I guess saying cab interior isn't necessarily incorrect. So, but for now, we're going to end this video, but I want to say thank you so much for watching and thank you so very, very much to all of my new subscribers. I really appreciate your interest and coming along to accompany me on this journey, whether it's the GP60M project or it's the freight car projects that I've done these mini documentaries on or just whatever else I come up with. Thank you so very, very much. It really means the world to me that you guys are taking interest and liking what I do. So for the rest of you, if you're new to the channel and you like the content, I ask that you please like and subscribe. Thanks a lot. We'll see you in the next video.